morning. Welcome to Hope. Would everybody rise with me? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, can we lift our hands to Him? Oh, here is my heart. Here is my body. But I just pray today that you would also say, Lord, here is my mind. So active, so engaged in the activities that surround us throughout the week. Yesterday is not with us anymore, as the old song would say. But I'm here today and I'm believing, Lord, as I lift my hands, that what is in front of me, Lord Jesus, is the fullness of your presence. For I'm inviting you to come into this room. And all, more importantly, to come into this temple. Have your way in me today. Oh, all those in this room and all those that are watching online, would you just glorify His name? Hallelujah. The name of Jesus. Jesus. Forgive us, cleanse us, wash us of all that we entered into this place with that might be unrighteous, impure from our thought down to the deepest crevice of our soul, that we may bring pleasure unto you today. Oh, as we sing praise, as we bring offering, as we come in accord and praying in agreement and giving ear, attentive ear to the word and responding, to you be all glory, praise, hallelujah, in this place. We thank you. We thank you. Oh, I just pray right now for each one that needs a touch in your body. We'll spend some time a little later in service if the Lord wills. But right now, if there's an area of your body that is just hurting or not well, would you just lay your own hand upon it and say, Lord, I believe. Oh, I believe. You may have to add this morning what the Scripture says, but help my unbelief. Oh, that we do not have to enter into these gates of thanksgiving with any affliction in our body if we would today apply by faith the blood of Jesus in our lives. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you, Lord God. Earlier in my prayer, those online, those in the house, thank you for being with us. Thank you for coming to celebrate the blessings of the Lord Jesus. Truly, we are a blessed nation. And I want to remind you that around the world, there are nations that have not the privileges that we have to gather in a public place to just worship the Lord. Do not take it for granted. Do not overlook the privilege that you have today. And let us, while we sing, while we listen, while we engage in the presence of the Lord Jesus today, let us recall that those nations that are around this world that are closed to the gospel, that today I pray that the Holy Spirit is in finding a way in. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you for our missionaries. Thank you for those that are serving, those that have gone into harm's way, that have set everything in their life aside, that the gospel might be just presented, proclaimed into the darkness of the world. Hallelujah. For who He is. Hallelujah. Let's just put our hands together and pray. Let's glorify Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Those hands together, give God the praise this morning. Yeah.
Anyone to come and to be anointed and prayed with in agreement. We need frontline worshipers. We're going to sing I Exalt Thee again, and maybe even a little bit of Worthy of It All, but I need those that are willing to step in front of those who need a touch in their body today. I want you to come, and I just want you to stand in the altar. And I want you to just enter into another level of surrender to the Lord today. Only you know where you are in what you have allowed the Lord to do in your life. But more importantly, what you have allowed the Lord to do through your life. And right now, I heard the Lord say, have those who would step in front of those who need a touch in their body and let their praise be what precedes my healing. So let us sing it again. As those have come forward, I want you just to just worship the Lord. Sing it, team. I exalt thee. In this room that needs a touch in their body, that may still be in your chairs or in the aisles, I want you to come and I want you to stand amongst those who are worshiping and praising the Lord as these frontline worshipers this morning come right now. I believe that this is an opportunity for you to receive of the precious gift of the Lord, that of divine healing. He spilt His blood on the way to the cross before He ever died and gave His life for you and I and our salvation that we so enjoy. I want you to know that He bled so that you would have, once receiving the fullness of your spiritual life being revived and renewed, your physical life would as well. So I want you today to trust in the Lord. They go hand in hand. So I ask you to just say, Lord, I want you to have everything. I don't want to reserve anything. I want to be healed. I want to be well. I trust that you are the Savior and the healer of all that I am right now. Here I am right now before you. In Jesus' name, by the blood, hallelujah, that was spilled on the way and trailed all the way up that mountain of Golgotha. And as He hung on that tree, suspended between heaven and earth, He said, it is finished. All that needed to be accomplished, oh, hallelujah, for His children that He loves so dearly, He said, it is finished. And I believe that today. I receive that today. Hallelujah. I am well. I am well by Jesus' precious gift that He has extended to me. Now, I want you to just pray for those that are around you, those that are in need this morning, those that have a call unto God. Maybe that call has come to you. You know that they need the touch of Jesus in their body, in their heart today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let this be so. In Jesus' name, we are praying for others today. We're lifting up others today. Their names, hallelujah, are crossing our lips. Hallelujah, forever believing and knowing that you are able, that even beyond these walls, to do great and mighty things. I am praying for Don Vickery, this wonderful man of God, his lovely bride, Connie. I'm praying, Lord, today, hallelujah, in agreement with him, as his prayers are being lifted up to you today, would you hear his prayer? Hallelujah. I know he is praying for your will to be done. I know he is releasing all control unto you. And I'm thanking you, Lord, that we can today join our prayers with him and Connie today, giving you glory. Hallelujah. 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 Woo! Glory! Glory! Hallelujah! 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 Praise God! Praise God! Praise God! Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord Ramasanda Riatiri Akita Rabashai. Holy, holy, holy are you. He is here. More than you can imagine, he is here. Oh, hallelujah. Beyond just a feeling, know this, that he is here. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We sing that part day and night. Hallelujah.
Day and night, night and day, let incense arise.
At home listening or wherever you might be, hallelujah, tuning in this morning, would you just lift up your voice? Let the incense, the Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speak. I pray that your heart is full of his glory, for you have just eliminated all that is within, that is that of sin, because you have confessed your sin to the Lord. So today there's purity that is coming from the depths of your soul. Hallelujah. Ha raba koto raba yoshoto raba ta da 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 ba yokit. Ha la da 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 ba yoko raba siki di 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 anda. She di 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 ando da di anda da da. Oh la ba 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 yaki baby di ama ba ba yaki baby ata. I pipi ando ribi asoto ribi kosiki di 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 ando. Hallelujah. 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 I believe that the Lord wants to speak to us today. And this is what I would hear him say, and I would give that to you, that he will not always strive with men. These opportunities are not always going to be available. The privileges of his presence will darken. Do not miss what is available. Do you believe and do you know that it is day and night? Day and night. And would you be obedient? Hallelujah. I just believe that's a word from the Lord today. And I think so many times we think we have tomorrow. And I think that we're waiting on something. We're looking for some great earthquake or mountain to move. Looking for some awesome, amazing miracle that just quenches all doubt. And then we're going to fall in line with his word. But I don't believe that you should put off tomorrow, till tomorrow, what he so desires today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, you're good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want every child in the room to take your mom and dad's hand. If you're close to them, just take their hand and say, Lord, would you bless my mom and dad? Would you just say, Lord, I pray for my mom and dad. They have so much they're responsible for, including me. But I pray for them right now. In Jesus' name. I just believe there's a great miracle in the house today. And if you are here today and you are in need of something that only God can do, and you are at the place where you're finally going to submit, and I say it in that manner not to bring condemnation or guilt, but because so often for just unknown reasons we hold on to some things. But you are at a point of desperation. If God doesn't intervene, there is going to be some catastrophe in the coming days. You need him. And I'm not just talking about healing, physical affliction. It could be anything in your life. It may not be great to someone else, but it's great to you. It is a heavy, heavy, heavy burden. If that's you, I want you to walk as close as you can to the altar so we can distinguish that it is you, that we might just be in prayer with you. I'm not going to ask you what that miracle is. We will ask that you testify as God reveals and answers, amen, that you might give him all glory. But if that's you, you need that miracle today. No matter what level or just size of your faith, trust him. I call upon you. I beg you almost, take a step towards the altar. Get close to the altar. Get beyond where you are right now. Let that be a significant role for you. Come on. Amen, amen. Who needs this miracle today? Who needs this miracle? Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. I just got goosebumps all up and down. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Two families, hallelujah. Two people already have stepped into the altars. Others are gathering around as we should. All you need to do is be in prayerful agreement. Just believe right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't want them to speak it because I don't want you to then to begin to doubt it and to just squash all the faith that they have. I want you to just say, Lord, do this work in them. Do what they are asking. And Lord, they're needing you to do right now. We thank you. Are you at home right now? Are you right now in need of a miracle? Hallelujah. I want you to text that right now. And my sound guys, they're going to wave at me back here and tell me there's somebody on there that has said we need something. And I want to pray for you specifically. Amen. I may not know who you are. Amen. Hallelujah. Is there someone? Hallelujah. Craig, let me know. Wave at me if somebody puts that on there. I'm believing that there is a miracle today. Hallelujah. That God has wanting to give to you. Oh, Rabasikiridiasi. He is worthy of it all. He is worthy of it all. Hallelujah. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Appropriate for us to give him thanks. So can we together give thanks to the Lord? We thank you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory to your name. You are worthy of it all. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that all, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah has been touched by you today. Yes. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise your name. Praise your name. Praise your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Would you greet someone in the name of the Lord today? Would you let them know, yes, he did it. He did it. I didn't do it. You didn't do it. He did it. Amen. He did it. Hallelujah. He did it. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Woo! Glory. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Rabasandarayaki. What a great day it is to be in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. There's still time for those of you online to share this live broadcast, so you can do that right now. Get other people on your page watching. Amen. Amen. If you're in the house, you're welcome to do that. I already know some of y'all. How do you do that? You're watching it on your screen, on your phone, and you're here in person. All right? Amen. Amen. So however that works for you, do that. Share that as quickly as you can. Praise God. I'm going to need a little bit more light up here, brother, so I can see. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I want you to take your Bible, if you would, God's holy word, Thank you very much. And I want you to go to 1 Samuel chapter 15. That's where I'm going to start. And then we're going to bounce around in the 1 Samuel part of the world, if you were. We're going to do our best to continue our talk on Samuel himself. As last week, you'll have to go back and look at it online. You have to go back and go to our website, myhope.tv. Check it out. But quickly, we talked about Hannah, and we talked about Phinehas' wife, the daughter-in-law of Eli, and the two of them having children. One was put into the service of the Lord and has experienced great things, and that's who we'll talk about in continuation today. The other, as she was giving birth, she recognized, she understood that the glory of the Lord had departed, for the family of Eli had been doing things that were, well, they were sin, they were wicked, they were wrong. Whichever one of those descriptive words you want to use, it was just not right. And she gave him the name Ichabod, where the glory of the Lord has departed. And so I want you to understand that we have a choice. The series is to be or not to be. It's really a play on those words of you making a decision. Of all the biblical examples that we see from cover to cover of who we might consider being more like, as we continue to move, as many of you would say, shouldn't we just be like Christ? Absolutely. Yes, indeed, to be like Jesus. But there are so many examples that give us the type of Christ, that show us a precursor, if you were, here in the Old Testament. And we want to look at their examples because I want you to see some of the things that you struggle with right here in Scripture. How many of you know we're not perfect? I had struggles this week. I believe you probably had some struggles this week. And I pray that today that we were able to come to the foot of the cross and say, Lord, I'm sorry. Help me to do better this week. Amen. Amen. I pray that each time, if you have a besetting sin, that is one of those continual, one of those things you keep going back to, you keep having a weakness in which you fail, which Samuel, you're gonna see that as he presents the life of Saul. Saul had some weaknesses, and we're gonna move into his world a little bit today. Listen, each time that you come to the Lord, I want you to get a greater distance between you and that. Strengthen it. Make your walk with the Lord stronger. And the only way you can do that is that you study to show yourself approved. You have to be in God's Word. You have to be in abiding time with the Lord. And that time is personal. That time is individual. But there are also times that you gather together either in small groups or you gather together in a little larger groups. And these days in 2021, in the coming out of what has been dubbed a pandemic, it's not the first time plagues have crossed the planet. Read about those five golden tumors in 1 Samuel, and the rats. And they use the word plague. This is not new. But each time, it is to really refocus the church. And I think that's what's happening right here in our place of worship. God is refocusing you and I on the priorities that we need to take a look at, and how we need to enter into each day, growing not only our own faith, but if we have children, our children's faith. I'm here in 1 Samuel chapter 15. So let's just jump right in here. Talk a little bit about Samuel. And we're going to go into the life of Saul. We'll get as far as we can today. And then I'm looking forward to next week, Pentecost Sunday, if I am correct. And, we're setting up Pentecost Sunday with Wednesday night Bible study. So come Wednesday night. You want to hear that. The teaching is going to complement that which is going to be on Sunday. You want to get that foundational layer, if you could. First of all, it says, Samuel also said unto Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint thee to be king over his people, over Israel. All right, we spent a few minutes talking about how Israel is God's chosen people. And what a great time for you and I to be reminded that we need to stand with Israel. You need to be praying for the peace of Jerusalem. You need to understand that the current events directly reflecting the scripture that has already been written. So don't be numb to it. Don't have a deaf ear to it. Hear what's going on. I know you got to filter all the fake news through and what is true and not true. But you know this. The scripture says Israel is important. It is the apple of his eye. Would you pray for Israel? But we're not going to talk about that today. We're going to single out two individuals, and one being Samuel and Saul. Now, therefore, hearken thou unto the voice of the words of the Lord. I need to go backward because I said we're going to talk about Samuel first. And so we're going to pick up. You know, Samuel was a young boy that was in the house of the Lord. He was serving the Lord. He was a child. He had already been weaned. We discussed that a little bit. It's not always what we think it would mean, being weaned, but he was at a place that he could be left. At the house of the Lord, Eli was his caregiver, and he trained him, which is really weird, isn't it, that Eli had two boys. It was his own flesh and blood. They were pretty bad boys, and then he had one that he didn't adopt him, but he pretty well was taking care of him as a son, and he did pretty good. That's why I tagged it with Mother's Day back to a godly mom was involved in that scenario. Praise God. Thank you again, moms, for being godly. Hallelujah. But Samuel here, I pick up in chapter 8, and I'm going to read just a little bit to you, because Samuel's place in the history of Israel is unique. Okay? He was the last of the judges. He was a prophet, and he also served as a priest, not just any priest, but the leading priest, which is interesting because he was not of the lineage of Aaron. Got that way because he didn't deal with sin real well in his own household. So at the end of today, if you were to take anything, is that consequences have consequences. Or consequences, decisions have consequences. Consequences have consequences too. But, you know, we're going to look at cause and effect of your decisions, your lifestyle, your actions, your reactions, your responses. You're always going to come back to nip you in the bud, Barney Fife. So I want us to look at this. Now Samuel, he says, and it came to pass when Samuel was old. So we've jumped from his youth, his childhood, to his youth, to now being old. He said that he made his sons judges over Israel. That's good. Stay in the family business here. Now the name of the firstborn was Joel, and the name of the second was Abihai. They were judges of Beersheba. And his sons walked not in his ways. That's an interesting decision. How many times did we read this in the Old Testament? Didn't we just read that about Eli? Now, Samuel has the same issue going on here. But they turned aside, and they looked, and you know what? They just, everything that they could do to pervert, really, the title, the position, the responsibility, they were doing. It says, now the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel, the tribal leaders. Now you got to understand, we haven't changed over to the monarchy and one leader. They haven't got a king yet. And this is kind of where it sets up here, is that now you still have all the tribal leaders. They come together and they're got to complain against the boys. All right? And we got to be careful here. We need to do a lot of praying for those young children of spiritual leaders. Because that's a tough place to be, folks. And it really is. So we need to pray for them. Not always be critical, okay? All right? And, you know, whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do you. So them, I kind of just throw that in there. Just kind of a tag. You know it was the Holy Spirit because it's not on the screen. Did a precursor. All right? They said, behold, thou art old. You know, I was called fat a couple of times this week. I wasn't really appreciative of that. I came up and said hello to somebody at our district council. Thank you all for the privilege and the honor of being able to represent not just our church, but the kingdom at our district council. And somebody walked up and says, you got a big mouth. Now, they meant it in a different way, but that's not how they said it. They said, you have a bit. So I've been called a big mouth. I've been called fat. You know, I've been called quite a few things this week. Here they are calling Samuel, you're old. And your sons don't walk like you. They don't talk like you. They don't lead like you. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. In other words, here Samuel done everything he could to kind of get rid of all these traditions and these worship practices and all of these bad things that all these other nations were doing. And now here we got these tribal leaders going, but we want to be like them. Wow, I just had a glimpse of Facebook for a moment. There are people that are not living for the Lord, and they are not exemplifying the things of Christ. They don't even spend time. They don't even know His voice. And yet they put things on there, and sometimes we get caught up going, I want to be like them. We deal with the same issues all the time, folks. We want to be like the other nations. But this thing, what? Displeased Samuel. Now, Samuel was very reluctant. He didn't like the idea. Well, it's because he spent time with the Lord. He understood Scripture. He knows the history here. And, you know, this yo-yo situation of, you know, of all those that preceded him. Some doing good, some doing bad. Most of the part, you know, we're finding them keep falling back into the despair of life of sin. But he's like, dude, don't do this. Give us a king to judge us, Samuel. Samuel prayed to the Lord. He's like, I'm going to go to the Lord on this. You know, I'm just going to go to the higher power here. I'm going to pass the buck. And the Lord did not take his side. He said, and the Lord said to Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected you. So now we're getting a little glimpse of where Samuel was, because he was in charge. He was the voice. He was the one who made decisions, and people would follow them. Because he heard the voice of God, he'd repeat it, but they wanted to oust him because you're getting old and your kids aren't following in your footsteps. So we need some hierarchy here. We need to be like everybody else. We need somebody to tell us what to do. Boy, that doesn't even sound right, does it? But that's what they wanted. And the Lord said, just know this. And I had to learn this as a pastor. Some of you as spiritual leaders, some of you as parents, you need to hear this because you're a spiritual leader in your own household. That when people in the church or people under your ministry or people in your own household reject or they don't agree with you when it comes to the things of God that you are trying to teach them, they're not rejecting you personally, they're rejecting the Lord. Here's a passage of Scripture that will back that up. He goes, they're not rejecting you, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. According to all the works which they have done since the day that I brought them out of Egypt, know this, Egypt was a turning point. Okay? Go back to the story, the Exodus, the children of Israel and following the presence of the Lord out of captivity into the freedom, into the promised land. So Egypt is always one of those places we go back to look. Even unto this day wherein they have forsaken me and served other gods, so do they also unto thee. Now therefore hearken unto thy voice, their voice, howbeit ye protest, yet protest solemnly unto them, and show them the manner of that the king would reign. In other words, go ahead, let them have a king, but make sure that you tell them all that they're going to get. Did y'all ever pray for something and get what you prayed for? Don't you wish somebody would have actually told you what you were praying for, and when you got it, what you were getting? No, because we were just like them. We were stubborn. We weren't listening to anybody, you know. And so the verse 10, and we'll move back a little further into the passage of Scripture. They're clamoring for a king, and Samuel told all the words of the Lord unto the people that ask of him a king. Now, it took a little while before he ever publicly, that being Samuel, recognized and endorsed Saul as king. Took him a little while. Good reading here. All right, but Samuel, he gained all kinds of recognition, and that of being the greatest prophet in Israel since the Mosaic times. I need to tag in a verse in chapter 10, though, because it's important here, because I told you it took a little while for him to endorse Saul, but he was obedient to the Lord even prior to that endorsement. Chapter 10, it says, then Samuel took a vial of oil, poured it upon his head, and kissed him and said, this has got to be hard for him. Is it not because the Lord hath anointed thee to be captain over his inheritance? In other words, he's saying, I got to pass the baton to you. Wow, that's got to be incredibly sobering to think, this is not good. This is not right. They're not going to overall, at the end of the day, going to be pleased with this decision. But I've got to do it. I've got to do it. That is that the definition of tough love? I know parents, sometimes we have to walk down that pathway. I'm looking around, you have children in your life, and sometimes you just got to, wow, that I'm their parent. I'm their leader. I'm their spiritual authority. And I can't release them. I know better. I have knowledge and experience that surpasses them. They're still wet behind the ears, so to speak. But sometimes we got to go, no, I've got to anoint and release and give over. It's time for someone else to have that authority. And ultimately, you know that they're going to see them for who they are. And they're going to regret. I hadn't titled this sermon, and there's so many different ways I could have gone. So maybe before the end of the service, we'll get that title. All right, let's get over into chapter 12. And here I wanted to read the entirety of this chapter. This is Samuel's final address to the children of Israel, setting this up to what I need you to take home today. And although Israel had turned to a king, the words of assurance, the prophet, stemmed the tide of apostasy and initiated, in effect, a prophetic movement in his teachings. His teaching continued, and he was continually there, in that he expressed his care and concern for the people. So, though, and that's a great word for parents of what I just came out of and telling you, that sometimes you have to kind of release your children. You got to give them over and let them be under of authority, that sometimes you're like, whoa, don't do this, but yet you do. But he didn't fully dismiss himself and go off, I'm just going to go out and get off grid and sulk and, you know, not have anything to do with them. No, he stayed a part of their life. And I love this passage, the only one I'll read out of this chapter 12, but the whole chapter is this whole just speech, if you would. But he says, moreover, as for me, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. But I will teach you the good and the right way. He did not stop. Samuel did not stop. This is the man who was raised by Hannah until the point that she gave him over to the service of the house of the Lord, into the hand of a person. And I don't think that Hannah was naive. I think she already knew, Eli, you didn't do too well with your boys. Probably already spread across the land that he had a grandson named Ichabod. Now, by this time, Eli and all of them had died, right? Because of their sin. But here Hannah has released him. He's there. But I imagine that Hannah never stopped praying. We know that she went every year at the annual feast and made him a new robe and gave it to him. Parents, you never stop being parents. Spiritual leaders, you never stop being spiritual leaders. Wherever in the world the Lord has you right now, you continue to be that. And so you have a responsibility. Even if someone is not listening to you, you still pray for them. Wow, that just spoke to me. There are sometimes I am very much aware somebody is not listening to the word being preached, but I still have a responsibility to pray for you. Only fear the Lord, I got to add that, and serve him in truth with all your heart, for consider how great things he had done for you. Consider this. I'm praying for you. We're teaching. We're still in encouraging you to come on Wednesday night and any time. And there will be future studies that are coming. And I can't say it enough. Make that effort. But know that we continue to pray for you even if you're not making your ears available. But verse 25 is a reminder. But if ye shall still do wickedly, ye shall be consumed, both ye and your king. I mean, he gives them his holes. He sets up, this is my credentials, this is my reminder, and this is my prophetic word to you. God is still your God. But if you turn your back on him, suffer the consequences. Okay, kind of handing the reins over to Saul. Chapter 13, Saul reigned 1 year. When he reigned 2 years over Israel. So we got Saul. He's been anointed as king. First sin. What? Yes. Saul is not. I told you they're going to regret this. See, Saul was given everything on a silver platter, maybe a golden one. He was just given it all. Here you go. It's kind of like Samuel said, I don't want to do this, but I'm giving it all to you. And this guy was popular. The scripture says that his popularity was, man, off chart. People looked at him. He was already head and shoulders above everybody else. He was a good-looking man to look at. He was just one of those guys. And he could really have written his entire life to be successful for the kingdom of God. But he had some weaknesses. I think that we're all like that. We have been given salvation. We have been given everything handed to us, saying, here's the favor of God in your life. Come on. And this will really shoot holes all in this once saved, always saved theology. Because, you know, cause and effect, we have been given such a great gift of salvation. What mercy, what grace. Saul did not deserve anything that was given to him. He was just this little snotty-nosed kid out there working for dad in a tribe that wasn't, you know, well-known. But yet, here he is. Become king. Authority. Man, when he spoke, people jumped, ran, did exactly what he wanted. But he had some weaknesses, and he never could get them under control. When you get saved, when you've been given everything by the Lord, all these promises are in here. Yes, they're yours. He wants you to be prosperous and successful. He wants you to be in abundance. And I know that there are a lot of people that preach that message all the time, but I love that phrase that we just recently started just sharing a little bit more in popularity. The good news is good news, but you got to know the bad news before you get the good news. And you can't forget that here, if you don't deal with your weaknesses, if you don't deal with things that might be down inside of you that is rotten, listen, it will find you. I bought a whole big old bag of grapes the other day. They were fantastic. The problem is, I went a couple of days that I didn't go grab out of the bag. There was a rotten one in there. And when I came back, it just caused several others to be rotten. It doesn't take much for this cankerous, sickness of sin to just spread everywhere. Saul had some weaknesses. And one of them apparently was impatience. I mean, we're not dealing with some... I mean, we got past some morality. He didn't have a story, which we'll talk about David. He had a weakness too. It was women. But his weakness was just impatient. How many of you just really quickly related to Saul? Have you ever been impatient? I mean, he knew what was to be done. And we pick up here in verse 8 of chapter 13. And he tarried 7 days according to the set time that Samuel had appointed. In other words, okay, I waited as long as you told me. But Samuel came not to Gilgal. And the people were scattered from him. And Saul said, bring hither a burnt offering to me and peace offerings. And he offered the burnt offering. Now, wait a second here. He is responsible at this time to acknowledge the prophet who represented God. There was a, can we use it for a better, for lack of a better way to say, there was a chain of command here with the king, to the King of Kings. And he stepped over it. What he began to do at this point began to be the problem in the future. He began to will his own power. He began to say, I have some wisdom here that I have authority and I can make decisions and not bother God or I don't have to wait on God. It wasn't against Samuel because Samuel already had this disclaimer given to him. It's not against you, buddy. It's going to be against me. That had to bring so much peace. I know as pastor, that brings a lot of peace to me. That when people lash out, and sometimes it's like, you know, again, I try to use my puppy at every servant. You know, when my puppy bites me, they're like, what kind of dog do you have? She still loves me. But, you know, there's just times that I may do something, you know, trying to pull something like a sticker burr out of her. That is trying to help her. But in her mind, that hurts. And she lashes out and bites me. Now, I want to throw across the room. I'm sorry, I'm working on this temper of mine. All right? You don't have that problem. Maybe you do, maybe you don't. But I'm trying to help. But I know that her biting me is not that she doesn't like me. She hates me. She loves me. She just doesn't want to be hurt. Same with people. Sometimes we're trying to pull a little splinter out. We're trying to help you to live your life in more like Christ. And that you might experience more of the blessings and favor that's in it. And sometimes it hurts, okay? And it's amazing how quickly and defensive people get. And when they do, they lash out. Thank the Lord. There's a scripture that says, and it reminds Bobby, they're not coming against you. Now, if you don't agree with that, I'm sorry. But I promise you, you'll face some things sometimes. You got to remember, if you're walking and you're doing what the Lord tells you to do, that's a whole different story if you step out of line and do your own thing. That's what we're talking about, Saul. He stepped out of line. I'm going to do my own thing. He made a sacrifice. And here's what Samuel, it reminds me of Adam and Eve. I mean, they ate a fruit, and here Samuel says almost the same words. What have you done? He already knew. I mean, if you're hearing the voice of God, I always hated it when my dad always said, I already knew that. How'd you know? The Lord told me. Really? Now I've learned how to hear the voice of God. I'm like, I know how you know. I mean, there are people that go, you read my mail and you're preaching against me. No, the Holy Spirit tells us what we need to speak on. But he did this. And Saul said, because I didn't see you, and the people were starting to scatter, I decided to do it on my own. Now, what he did was not wrong. The burnt offering? Offering up and having incense day and night to the Lord, that's a good thing. The Lord, but the Lord has a way intended for you and I to burn that incense, to bring that incense, maybe to bring that worship, that praise. And so we got to be careful to not, you know, put our expectations on how we should do it, where the Lord is the one who gives the direction. And Samuel said, I like this. I don't know. That's why I like King James. I know some of you, can't you get one of these other versions? And I read them too. But I like this. He goes, I forced myself, therefore, and offered a burnt offering. Really? You had to force yourself? Oh, I had to make myself do what needed to be done. Because he had to do it because in his mind, he knew he was not the one to do it. Samuel said to Saul, thou hast done foolishly. Thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, which he commanded thee. For now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever. Key verse. I would have established you forever. You know, forever is a long, 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 long time. You get saved. You get washed in the blood of Jesus. The Spirit of God is now your guide. Those of you that know what I'm talking about and come back Wednesday and Sunday. Have I said that enough? You need to know. You need to understand the Spirit of God. But I'm telling you, the world is yours on a platter. God has given you. I mean, Adam and Eve had everything. Just don't do this one thing. And then... Saul had everything. The kingdom was his. Verse 14, but. Don't you just hate those two little words, the one but and the other one's if, in Scripture? But now thy kingdom shall not continue. Now that's got to be just a kick in the old backside. Wait a second. You pull me out of my comfort of my house where I'm now chasing my father's donkeys around the country, just doing my thing, you know. And I had my whole plan of where I was going to college, who I was going to marry, where I was going to build my little house. And you pull me up, bring me king, give me all this, get my hopes up for the world. And then because I do one little thing out of order, you're going to take it all away. The Lord has sought him a man after his own heart. Oh, you've been hearing me talk about this. Oh, yep, it's coming. His name's David. We'll get there in a few weeks, so maybe. But he said, I'm already picking somebody out, and the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over the people because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded. Do y'all know that the commands of the Lord are very important? I know the boys and girls in here already know that. They get it because they know mom and dad's commandments are important. But somewhere along the line, when we get a little bit older, it's kind of like Saul. He's got a little longer in the tooth and moving along. You got to think, you know what? I can make decisions on my own. Our culture has caused this, that at a certain age, you make your own decisions. You make your own way and your own path. You leave mom and dad's house. You just go do it. Wait a second. Get out beyond the boundaries of the teachings and the commands of God. Well, I'm back to chapter 15. And I'll just paraphrase, because there's a lot. We should read the whole chapter. It says, thus the Lord of hosts, I remember that which the Amalekite did to Israel. Those are all those countries, those nations, when they crossed the river. You know, they first faced Jericho. You know, the walls of Jericho come down, then they have other ones they got to conquer and defeat. They're there. But he told them, he said, I want you to go and smite them. Kill them. Eradicate them. And utterly destroy all that they have. Don't leave anything. No souvenirs here. Okay? Spare them not. But slay both man and woman. There are people that are tuning me out right now because they're like, really? God would go to such great lengths? God would? Man, woman, infant, and suckling, ox, sheep, camel, and ass. I love King James because you can use words like that. It's just scripture. I don't get dinged for being a cusser, okay? And Saul gathered the people together, and he went out, and he did not do what he was commanded to do. Second sin, second failure. Maybe that's the title, Epic Fail. Woo! Man, he didn't learn from it. I think that after I heard he's about to take it away, I would try to start doing some things that would cause him to possibly change his mind. But he has a weakness. His weakness is his own self-power. Now I have and it is a thing that we were created with, is self-will. We make our decisions. We get to do what we choose to do. And that's okay if those choices first have passed the desk of God and God has told you what his will is. That's when we get to the word surrender, I give up. You know, maybe we need to sing I Surrender All, Benji, when we get to the end of service, because we need to be reminded this is all, is everything. But we got a problem here. But Saul and the people spared Agag, the king. He didn't carry out the fullness of the order. And the fatlings. There's that fat thing again. My goodness. Well, I could button it. I had a hard time getting one belt. You know, you know what I'm talking about. You got one hole on your belt. You're going to go there regardless. That's the one you wore out. That's the one you came to dinner with. That's the one you're going away with dinner with. After being gone for a few days at the council, I'm like, wow, that hole was hard to get in there. When you're cinching up a horse, you know, sometimes you got to kick it in the belly for it to, you know, get that hole. Man, that's tough. That word fat just keeps coming back. But he saved them. He said he saved all that was good and would not utterly destroy them. But everything that was vile and refuse, they destroyed utterly. In other words, they made a decision. They determined what was good and what was bad. We were watching a TV show. I thought we were binge watchers, but apparently I've learned that the definition of binge is not what we do. Okay? And so we are not. But we do like one of these shows, and we're watching it. And there was someone that their intellect was not where others might be. They just did not have all the advantages in life that other people had. So I kind of had this, as I was rereading and visiting this scripture again, I kind of had this thought, is that how would you like it if I made the decision, looked in the room and go, yeah, you're good. You notice I went to my wife first. And I'll look over here and say, and you're bad, you know. So there was a decision by a person and a group of people, you'll live, you'll die. And the decision was based upon what I deemed was the best. What I attributed value to. Are you getting the picture here? Because y'all have read further in the book, and Jesus attributed value that all would be saved. He died for everyone. He did not say, I'm only going to do it for this group. Those who can grow facial hair and those who couldn't, sorry. I think about this for a moment. And not only that, you could put this in any category. We take the best of everything and we assume it just belongs to us and we get rid of the rest. In this, wouldn't this be a great place to talk about tithe for the moment? That was in my reading for We're Burning Daylight, by the way. You can catch a little bit of that scripture in the morning if you so choose. But he wants what's first and best in our lives. Ultimately, because there's no promise that we'll get any more. So we're trusting him that, all right, we give you the first crop. Will we even have a second crop? You know, it's kind of like the rain. In Texas, you never know when it's going to rain. When it rains, by the way. But we harvest and we reserve and we hoard from the first batch because we're not assured of the next batch. But when you have the Lord completely in charge and in control, you say, I trust you. And this is where Saul is making a mistake. And I believe people in the house of God and people who call themselves Christian, and I did this little quote thing, because everybody's a Christian, by the way, because we live in a Christian nation. And because we just believe, listen, we are thieves. We are thieves in America. We steal the best. We hoard the best. Pastor Blinda wouldn't say it last week, so I'll give her credit for it. But wouldn't we and shouldn't we send our best to the nations that they might share the gospel of Jesus Christ? No, we reserve them here. We send the expendable ones. Because if we lose them, it'd be okay. Probably she would have done that a lot better than me. Yeah. But here he was. And then he did this ultimate fail. Oh, man. You know, when you start making a mistake, you really don't know where you're going. Now you're in a chaotic, you're just one fail after the other. And then he's like, we did it so that we can honor God in our worship. Oh, my goodness. Oh. The people. Oh, that made me think of Moses and Adam. Adam, that woman you gave me. We always pass the buck. And Moses, these people that you gave me. Here's Saul. These people that you made me king over. I didn't want to be king, but you put me as king, and now they made me do this. They didn't make you do this. I put you as king because you had the resolve to be able to stand up and make a decision that would honor God, but you choose not to. He yielded to the pressure of the people. Have you ever seen that in the house of God? With fellow Christians that maybe don't even attend the house of God? Or with just anybody? They crumble in the pressure of people. And usually it's not that there's this pointing the finger or this threat. It's usually as gentle as, I just want to be liked by them. And sometimes they don't even have to speak. It's whether or not they have a little ding with a little like on their Facebook. And I'll do anything if that one person would just highlight the little thumbs up. Please just do it. Oh, yes, they did it. Pastors struggle with that all the time. I look at everybody who makes comments before I eat lunch most often on Sunday. And that's not always good. Because you think of the prophet who got caught out in the wilderness after a great victory, and then he's letting one woman bring fear into him out there. We continued. You mean I have some weaknesses? Yes. I struggle with them. I have to work on them. But I think that everyone in the room has a few things. That's why we should give an altar call every time we're in church so that everyone gets to work and come again and again. And each time we lay down our weakness, when we get up, I pray that we're further and further away from that being a problem in our lives. They set up a contrary authority and impeach the wisdom of God. Pulled that out of a commentary. I thought that was pretty cool. We're saying, God, I got this. You didn't realize that that little fat cow over there would be a really good worship. Think about this, though. But then before I sacrifice, I could dip my fork in there. See, the scripture, it's not just one story. It all goes together. And I can get out, and if I'm following after Eli's kids, I'll get it beforehand, and I'm going to be fat. There it comes again. There are a lot of just fat Christians that go to church. They spend more time on their flesh and the pleasures of life, and doing it their way. Verse 20, and Saul said to Samuel, "Yea, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord, you liar, and I have gone the way which the Lord sent me." Lying again. "And I have brought Agag, the king of Amalek." He didn't even know what he's saying, "and I utterly destroyed all the Amalekites." Kind of like stealing a sheep, and you're hearing, like, you don't have a sheep? What's that noise in the other room? Sounds like a sheep to me. No, it's my phone ringer. No, I stole the sheep. "But the people took the spoil, the sheep and the oxen and the chief of things which should have been utterly destroyed to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God." Come on, Samuel, get with the program. This is the 2021 way of doing church. And Samuel said, "Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice." Been quite a topic of conversation at my house over the last 24 hours. Been good conversation. "And to hearken than the fat of rams." We need to learn to submit our heart, will, and intellect to the authority of Christ. We need to learn to say yes to the Lord. And it is said that the word sacrifice, it denotes the religious activity, those things that Scripture declares, but yet we have to be obedient to the Lord. Obedience surpasses any and all things. Obey what? First of all, 66 books. It's in this little nice binder of a library. It's there. And I'll spend some time reading it. I was just interesting because I'm Googling. 667, this says sins. I want to run through all of them. I say that's a lot of sins to look at. But, you know, these are things that we should not do, but the opposite is that we should do. And it's not always about just making our life miserable. It's actually about making our life prosperous and successful. But we live in a culture that thinks that this is just messed up. It's turned around. People, and I like this. I wrote this down in its quote. "People do not dispute the authority of Christ. especially in Texas. You're far, there's a few, it's there. The percentage, though, is not great of people that would dispute that there is a God, that God has authority. And, you know, you're like, well, I know some. No, I'm just saying overall, vast majority. Okay, but this is what happened here. Not disputing his authority, but yet for some unknown reason that they themselves can't even articulate. People are not willing to repent of sin. People are not willing to commit to Christ. People are not willing to cast out sinful desires. And people are not willing to bow in all things to the yoke of Jesus. That's like the scripture. You know to do good, and you just don't do it. We know what needs to be done and how to do it, but we just don't. Galatians 6, 7, and 9 really brings some light in the New Testament. Be not deceived. That means don't be lied to. Don't get caught, I would say, like Saul. Get your mind twisted. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall also he reap. And then I have to do this because my dad preached this to me. This is, you know, you parents, you know, you got like 6 or 7 messages. You're like an evangelist. That's not a bad thing. All right? Sorry if you're out there listening to evangelists. But they really fine-tune those. My dad preached this one all the time. For they sow the wind, and they shall reap the whirlwind. Nah, that wasn't a Churchill original. That's not what his quote. No, that come from Scripture. Now, one of them really has to do with the individual, but the other one has to do with the community. Sowing and reaping is a common analogy throughout the Bible to demonstrate cause and effect. The direct fruits of our labor, the consequences of our actions. The context is, on the second, the whirlwind, has to do with the community. He's speaking to the children again. We're still in the book of the Old, the books of the Old Testament here. And then we have one on the end. So individually and communal, is that the right way to say that? My wife's going, she's impressed with that one. Pulled that one out of a hat. Because I get tongue-tied up here. I can't see, beyond my eye tooth. You know, so we got these two. So some actions that we do that are not right in the eyes of God affect you. And you're going to reap that. There's a cause and effect. You're going to do something, you know. I made a mistake the other day. My feet do not see the light of day. I am a shoe person. I just don't do it. But the other day I was in a hurry. I had my socks on. See, I'm very concerned about my feet. But I had to go out to the truck, and I went out there in my socks only. The cause and effect. I came back, pulled the stickers out of my socks. My feet hurt because I don't touch rocks. Some of y'all can walk on rocks, never even know you walked on rocks. Your feet are so tough. But I'm just like, that's a compliment, I guess, because I don't know. But mine are not. I was crying like a baby. Cause and effect. We do that all the time. That affected me. Didn't affect Lisa. But then there are some things that I do that will affect her. For instance, when I get out to close the gate, and I on one of our Texas days that are 110 degrees, and this is one that I have a weakness in, and she lets me know quite often, I leave the door open to go close the gate because I'm like, I don't want to wear out the hinges on my door open and closing. And she's in there, close the door, you're letting out all the AC. Some of you know what I'm talking about. That decision affected her. All right, let's move on down the list. Individually, in the church, some of the decisions that you make have a cause and effect. So you choose not to tithe. Okay? Read the whole chapter of the tithing on Malachi. I heard a preacher here recently preach, the greatest insurance policy against COVID is if you tithe. You just read. There is a consequence if you don't trust the Lord enough to return to Him what's rightfully His. Some of y'all are like, how did you turn this into a message? Money. Because it is one of the most practical, tangible ways for you and I to understand. So if you are sick and struggling physically and you don't tithe, it could be because you don't tithe. And you could pray all the time for healing and have people pray for you. But if you continue to be disobedient, you are not going to receive a healing. Well, I don't like what you said. That's okay. They didn't like everything Samuel said. Just saying. My wife told me I've been a little too general lately, so we'll just be a little bit more direct. And if you're lying, listen. If you're lying to your work, how do you lie at work? Well, do you give the full time at work? Some of you ladies, you work way beyond your boundaries. Some of you, you cheat time. I heard someone this week, let's just kind of delay. I don't really want to go back to the office too quick. When the promotions come around and you don't get a promotion, why don't I get a promotion? Because somebody, because your sins will find you out, is what the scripture says, has told on you that you fudge a little bit at lunch, you fudge a little bit when it's time to go home. So don't ever expect a promotion. And you, I almost wanted to say bitch, but I'm not going to say that. But I got some of your attention. I got some of your attention. Because that's what you do. And you call the pastor up and God knows I need a raise or I need a promotion and I need you to pray. And I can pray. You're wasting my time praying if you have sin in your life. Cause and effect says you are like the guy I saw in 87 who it's raining. Like it doesn't rain in our area. It's muddy. And no wonder two pickups have changed trying to pull him out of the pasture. And my question to my wife is, why are you in the pasture? It's not a road. They just took the fence down to clear it. Why are you out there? And why are you going, why am I stuck? Because you're an idiot. Cause and effect. Some of them are individual. Then some of them affect the whole body, the community. Some of your sins, and I can't help but not mention Achan, buried something under his tent, hides it down in there. Let everybody in the camp think that they're doing right. People come to church all the time. Everybody thinks you're doing right. You're good. I really get, wow, so many people on Facebook, if they truly believed what they put there in Scripture and all those little posters on their Facebook, I would be ecstatic. But I just don't see the consistency in the Scriptures that you put on Facebook and the lifestyle in which you identify with in some of your posts a little later on. We hide sin, but that affected the whole camp. How many times? I like the story this week I read, and Saul's like, kill the person who's did this wrong. It was his own son, Jonathan. And they started throwing these lots out and started to come down to me and him. And I wonder what Saul's like, wow, it's me or you. Well, I'm the king. I'm just going to kill you. But that's got to be a tough decision. When the lot fell on him, he's like, what did you do? I didn't agree with your decision, so I decided to do it anyway. But it doesn't matter. My word is. And that's where Saul was making the big mistakes. He's like, my word is. And some people that you just don't realize, we are still, at the end of the day, the creation of God. At the end of the day, we're still His children, His chosen people. Oh, I thought that was Israel. Yes, but we are, praise God, grafted into the vine. And we get this arrogance about us. Slide the word pride in there. Which goes before a fall. Listen, for leaders, from leaders to the worship of idols, we divert our attention from God. Actions bring on our destruction. Saul disobeyed, and through his disobedience, forfeited the kingdom. Now, I am so thankful for mercy. I got dinged this week for not using grace enough. I'm going to tell you, His grace and mercy are sufficient. But even God gets tired sometimes of us taking advantage of that just in using the words. And here's the thing. I don't know if Saul will be in heaven. That's not for me to know. I don't know. Well, you said he sinned. And he asked for, he repented, man, forgive me, give me back. We're still going to reap what we sow. That's a hard one for me. I hope that it's not as severe a consequence of things I did prior to salvation. Which for me, well, I got saved at 7, so like what real bad stuff can you do before 7? For some of you, it would be different. But I don't know. Though Saul had these moments in his life of, I'm sorry, I made a mistake, he still lost everything. Is it worth it, guys? Is it worth it? The final straw for Saul, I think, is that he went and this is not the Lord of the Rings, but the woman of Endor. Man. And if he's a glutton for punishment because he wanted Samuel to come back, who's like, I'll tell you the same thing again. Oh, please, you didn't change your mind? No. Because God didn't change his mind. Although God chosen and anointed by the praying prophet Samuel, Saul failed to realize that obedience was essential in the sacred and unique trust afforded him by God when, chapter 10, verse 1, he was anointed to be captain over his inheritance. To much is given, much is required. Okay. Be or not to be. Please don't be like Saul. Recognize your weaknesses today. And do whatever you can with the help of the Lord, because Lord knows, really, and I don't mean that as a cliche, Lord knows, you cannot overcome your weaknesses without help. And don't forfeit everything that is promised you on this side of heaven or on that side. In eternity, because of some acts of disobedience. One last word. I pulled this, I'm going to pull it right out of the commentary. I brought it up here. To him as king, talking to Saul, whose word was supposed to be law to his subjects, there is something very appropriate in the prophet assuring him that this preference of his own will, remember, that was his weakness, his own will, he was choosing it. However plausible the reasons for it, listen, we can make an argument of why some of our ways seem to be good. Was not a simple weakness or fault, but nothing less than a rebellion. Because the next verse for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. And stubbornness, stubbornness. Heard this on TV the other day, because we don't want to use the word stubborn anymore. Belief, perseverance. What? Is as iniquity and idolatry. It is setting up man's will as a more desired will than God's. And here's what he told him with the Amalekites: to exterminate all evil, all the Amalekites. And this is what the commentary, with many references, said: we too, as Christians, we need to exterminate all evil. We need to exterminate, eradicate all sin in our life. So when he gives us, he didn't tell us to kill the Amalekites. He told us to surrender all sin in our life, in our whole life. All of it. Not trying to save the best part of yourself and say, I'm doing that, so then I can give it to God in worship. No, he said all of it. Powerful verse. Create me a clean heart, renew in me a right. Start over. Bow our heads, close our eyes. Benji, would you come and play that song, I Surrender All? I appreciate that. By the time he starts playing, I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to identify if there's any weaknesses in your life. They may not be sin at the moment. They're just things that you struggle with. And today, you need help. Now, here's the cool thing. Next week's Pentecost Sunday, he said, I'm providing a helper. His name is the Holy Spirit. So this is a great segue into next week. You don't have to wait till next Sunday. You can come Wednesday night. But even prior to receiving the opportunity to receive the Holy Spirit next week, you could receive the Holy Spirit today, but begin with, Lord, I'm having some struggles. I'm having some issues. I'm having some challenges. I don't want to be like Saul. I would like to be more like Samuel, that though he had to hand over the leadership and the authority to someone he knew wasn't to be the one, because that's not what God originally wanted to be, he still did it because he was obedient. Sometimes you're going to be asked to do something that you just don't want to do. You have a better way to do it. There's a right way that seems right to a man, but in the end, God's way is the only way. God's way is the only way. And let's not be like some people when you tell them, hey, can you go out the front door? And they stop and they go, why? Why? I want to go out the front door. When they should have just did what was said to them, because they didn't know that there would maybe a snake rolled up on that door that you just told them. See, we're always in the defensive, questioning, want to know. Then we get we want to do it our way. No. Sometimes, if you're driving down the highway, one last illustration, in your car, it will never make sense to you to stop in the middle of a highway. I'm exaggerating here, but it could be so. Why would you just stop? But if you can hear the voice of God, and that needs to be a teaching and a preaching that I bring, hearing the voice of God. I know this, and I will. But if he said stop, would you argue? Would you disobey? Would you say, no, that I know this? Would you just keep going? But you don't know what 100 yards or a mile down the road God was stopping you from encountering. You never know what's up ahead. God does, though. He knows how it will affect you, and he knows how it will affect others. He knows how it will affect your house, and he knows how it will affect your church. He knows how it will affect your work. All we have to do is be willing to be obedient, hear his voice, and to do his will, not our will. So when he sings the first word, I want you to come. Find a place. We don't tarry long today, but I do want you to come and take a moment and say, Lord, help me with this. Help me with this. You need to ask for forgiveness, then ask for forgiveness. Young people, would you come too? If you're struggling, or if there's an area that you need to have a firmer foundation with Christ, as these are areas that you're having problems with, I want you to come. Stand with me. Let's sing it.
Oh, to Jesus.
Magnify your holy, precious name. Take home this altar time with God. Spend some time with Him. Even on Sunday evening. Oh, messing with your evening. Just spend some time with the Lord. Worship Him and glorify the Lord. Listen to Him. Let us develop ears that hear. Amen. We're going to cover that subject. Now we are a couple of things that we want to make mention of. As always, we want you to worship the Lord in giving, returning of your tithe and offering. You can do that in various ways, many ways. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you. We're wanting to install cameras around our campus. And several men have stepped up to say this is, they're right in there behind it. And we've also taken up a substantial offering to begin, but we only are halfway there. So if you want to put money in Seed Faith today, just do the date that's on the calendar, 16. If everybody did $16 a day, it probably would get us all the way, and we would know we'd have sufficient funds. That way we can install these, and that would give those that have been serving so well in many areas opportunity to have a little bit more of a confidence with those things, not just while we're here, but when we're not here. Also, if you want to be a part of our church, as a member of our church, we're going to have a makeup class, 6 o'clock Wednesday night. It promises to be direct and right in there, so it won't take much time. Many of you have asked. We're going to do that. We'll finish in time to come in, be where the teaching is and Bible study following that. And so we want you to be a part of that. And also, the men have wanted to gather together, and we're going to have a meat gathering. You bring meat, throw it on a pit. Thank you, Herman. He's going to play. You have the pit fired up. I just hope somebody brings a fork. If not, so be it. Praise God. It's going to be a good time. Keep praying for one another. Keep expecting. And one more thing. Brother Vickery's still with us. I'll be honest with you. He'd be all right if he went home to be with Jesus today. Text me this morning. But as long as he's with us, he needs to hear from his church family. So if you want his phone number and you don't have it, you text me. I'll send it right back. Send him a text. Make a phone call. Many of you have gone out to see him. You're welcome to go out there. You will be preached to. You will be prayed for. You will be challenged. You may become a missionary before you leave. That'd be okay, wouldn't it? Some of you love to serve and making meals. You're more than welcome to. You can talk to Pastor Stephanie. She can help you with any details. But listen, no one turns down a meal when you need one. But Brother Vickery is a prophet who needs a prophet's honor. So we need to honor him and Connie. And Connie, ladies, little note, little call. Amen. Thank you for what you do as the body of Christ. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.